Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. First of all, I would like to thank the organizing committee for inviting me to share with you the problem of the surgical management of cataract keratoconus, and special thanks to Dr. Ashraf Sharar and Dr. Ahmed Elmassry for organizing this meeting. Again, the problem of cataract and keratoconus maybe had been highlighted by Dr. Ahmed Said in his talk and the questions later on by the panelists. And simply, I'm going to summarize or to simplify how to deal with the patient with keratoconus who developed cataract, and may concentrate on three main pillars for the problem, which is the age and the stability of the cornea and the stage of keratoconus or ectasia in general. So the main problem, as all of us know, is the IOL calculation and refractive outcomes in ectatic corneas in general. So the first question to be asked, is this cornea stable or the cornea is not stable? And we mean by stability, and which depends on the age. If the patient is less than 30 years of age and the cornea is unstable, we have to cross-link this cornea. This is effect. You cannot do cataract surgery for a patient who has unstable cornea. But if the patient is more than 30 years of age, which is the most common situation that we face with the cataract patients, here there is a debate, because all of us know that most these patients have stable cornea and there is no need for cross-linking the cornea and just follow up by pentacam every 6 months. So, first of all, for any ectatic cornea, before doing the cataract surgery, to have a good IOL calculation, we have to have a stable cornea. As all of us know, the signs of stability or the progression of keratoconus is thinning of the cornea, more than 10 microns per year, or increase of the curvature of the cornea more than 1.5 diopters per year, or increase of the difference between the superior and inferior meridian more than 1.5 diopters. If the cornea shows instability, we have to stabilize it. The second question after having stable cornea is the cornea regular or not irregular, which means, is this cornea, can we depend on the care readings for accurate biometry or not? The point that had been raised by Dr. Ahmed Said. How to make the cornea irregular before the cataract surgery? Intracorneal link segments combined with cross-linking, if there is progressive ectasia, had been proved to have stable and regular cornea. In another way, to be more systematic, after cornea stability, we have five scenarios. We have a stable cornea, and the first scenario, mild irregular cornea, K-max up to 52 diopters. The second is moderately irregular cornea. The K-max is higher, up to 62 diopters. The third scenario, if the patient cannot put, or the doctor cannot put, ICRs, or the ICRs are not applicable. And the fourth scenario, if you have advanced keratoconus. And the last scenario, if you have post-PKP cataract. The first scenario, mild irregular cornea with the K-max up to 52 diopters. Of course, pentacam is mandatory. Optical care readings and ultrasonic biometry are essential. As we have heard before, third generation formula, Higgs L, Shammas, Musket, Holiday 2, all these formula should be or should have the result of within 2 diopters of the Higgs L formula for this high K corneas. For example, this patient who has keratoconus is about 30 years of age, and the right eye we did first cross-linking and the ICRs, and for the left eye we did cross-linking only without ICRs because the cornea was not so steep. And after a few months, this is the result. It had been improved markedly in the eye with the intracorneal link segments and cross-linking, and also flattening of the left eye with the cross-linking on. This patient is about 30 years of age. He developed cataract later on. First, we have to wait not less than 6 months after the cross-linking and the intracorneal link segments to stabilize the cornea to depend on these care readings. Astonishingly, for this patient, for his left eye, who had cross-linking only, the lens was hard. He was just 30 years of age with this hard cataract. This means that mostly the right of Leavitt and the ultraviolet rays had penetrating the cornea and reached the lens, and the lens had been cross-linked. That's why this patient developed hard cataract later on. And of course, this patient you can put an aspheric or a spheric IOL depending on your choice. Preferable for this angle than aspheric IOL as long as you have regular cornea. The second scenario, patient with moderately irregular cornea, the K-max had passed 52 diopters and reached up to 62 diopters. As you have heard, you cannot depend on this stable but irregular cornea to do the IOL calculations. So in these cases, we have to regulate the cornea, whether by intercorneal segments or cross-linking, and wait for 3 months after ICRs to do the pentacan optical biometry, as we said before, the Higgins L, the mask and Chambers, also Dr. Hill will ask it online, and you have heard from the different formats. The surgery itself is not different from the regular one. Yes, you can see the lens clearly. Yes, you can do all the steps at ease, and there is no problem of the intracorneal ring segment during surgery. And after 1 day, the cornea is clear, and there is no extra surgical skills. And as we have heard all the time, A for myopia in keratoconic patient. This patient had -2 and -2 astigmatism after the surgery. But it's not all the time like this. Sometimes, after intercorneal segments, the cornea may be very difficult to see what's behind. With corneal opacities and the surgery, despite being young age girl of about 25 years of age, she had previously intact with infection and rejection. She was also leucomatous. The other eye had PKP. So sometimes the surgery is challenging. It needs longer time, it needs patience from the doctor, it needs long time after the surgery to have stabilized refraction. So it's not all the time after the ICRs and the intacts to have a peaceful and simple surgery. The third scenario, as I said, the first one, mild irregularity up to 52, the second, moderate irregularity have to stabilize, the third, if this patient cannot put ICRs for a reason or another. The reason of not putting an intercorneal segment due to advanced cataract, the surgeon cannot predict which type of intercorneal segment to be put. As you all know, there is a certain nomogram to put the rings, and you have to know the visual axis, the chromatic axis, the refractive axis, and to combine all of these to have good result with the ICR. But if the cataract is advanced and the cornea is irregular, here you cannot put the ICRs blindly. Or if the patient cannot afford for this ICR. Here the scenario differs. We have to make the surgery on steps. First, remove the cataract, especially when you have an IOL master or biometry with astonishingly high range of power. I sent the case for Dr. Hani Hilali and he sent it back to me with -17 and -15 diopter of IOL. Yes, I trust the Hani for his biometry, I trust the machine, but I cannot trust this axial length. This very irregular cornea. I cannot put -17 IOL. In this case, just remove the lens, leave the patient aphakic, and after the surgery, do subjective refraction for the patient, and try to put RGB or rigid gas penumbra lens or the hard contact lens, which is a very good tool, usually missed by most of the surgeons to put this RGB, only just to know whether this patient will benefit from the contact lens or not, or if he can withstand the lens or not, or if you can put an ICR later, or if you can put an IOL later. So there is the role of these hard contact lenses after doing the cataract in the patient effect. So if the patient can afford, you can put later on, after the surgery, intercorneal ring segments. And in these cases of high myopia, usually having large axial length, the 320 degrees or the 355 degrees intercorneal segments are very valuable. After that, you can decide whether to put a secondary IOL in the back or sulcus, or this patient doesn't need this intraocular lens. The toric IOL is a still a debatable point to be discussed. Toric IOLs do not have good results in very irregular corneas, nor do the opposite clear corneal incisions or the femto-arc incisions. But again, this point is still debatable. because we have to have certain considerations for putting the toric IOL in the regular corneas. We have to highly select the patients that we have heard from the panelists before, and we have to have stable, mild or moderate cornea with good vision before surgery and without any corneal scar, of course, and as you have heard, the axis of the cylinder on topography, tomography, keratometry, IOL master, let's start. All of these K readings should be within few degrees that you trust these machines, and you can put this K reading here, you can put the toric IOL. The fourth scenario, if you have an advanced keratoconus, and all of us know the signs of advancement, whether the pachymetry is less than 400 microns, K-max past the 62 diopters, or endothelial folds, or hydrops, or any vox stripe. Here, you can do the triple procedure, doing the deep anterior lamellar with the fake and IOL, or if there's hydrops, here to do the PKP and cataract extraction and IOL, depending on the other eye care readings, or as we heard, we can do just the PKP and wait for a year, and then you can do the cataract later on. The fifth scenario, as you have heard from Am, the post-PKP cataracts. You have to wait for 1 year to depend on the case of this cornea. You have to do specular microscopy for these patients, and you have to clarify that the cornea could fall down or decompensate after the surgery because its endothelial cell count is definitely less than the normal. Full explanation of the rejection of the graft for the patient, and of course, to protect the cornea with the, whether to do soft gel technique or Arshinov, using the different viscoelastics, and all of the time keep in mind to use very low amount of ultrasonic power, and of course, the less the power, the more preserving the endothelium. Keeping an air bubble behind the cornea also is another trick to preserve the corneal endothelium. This is the same patient after 1 day of surgery. So to conclude, counseling and complete explanation to the patient that we have a problem of the intraocular lens power calculation because your cornea is not normal is very important to be clarified. Adequate preoperative investigation should be done. All the tools that you have should be used. All plans and tools to protect, stabilize, and regrade the cornea. The least ultrasonic power and enough time for these corneas to have the final result. It's another message. If you have a patient post-refractive surgery, post-RK, post-LASIK, post-keratoplasty, usually don't depend on the refraction that you have immediately after the surgery because this cornea takes a longer time to be stabilized, not less than a few weeks, from 6 to 8 weeks to have the final refraction. Don't hurry to exchange the IOL if you find the patient hypo or have a strange refraction. To summarize, stabilize the cornea, whether by cross-linking or natural stabilization by pH, regulate the cornea, whether by the rings or hard contact lenses, may postpone intraocular lens implantation to a second session, always target low myopia in keratoconic patients with a regular cornea, advanced keratoconus to the triple procedure, and the toric IOLs still have a role in very selected patients. Thank you very much.